Please join me in welcoming Jennie Magiera.
Thank you.
So what I want to do before we get started is talk to you about what I do. So I, again, was a fourth and fifth grade teacher for years and years, and then they asked me to leave the classroom to take on a district level role, and I said no, and they said why, and I said because I like kids and not grown-ups. And they said, I know, right? And then they said to me, well, they came back and they said, well, please, can you? Because we have all this technology and we don't know what to do with it. And I said, only if I get to continue teaching. I'll only take a district job if I can teach at least once a week. So I teach once a week, fourth, fifth, and sixth graders. And as I was packing my bags to go in my office and getting all my tech ready to head over to Q, one of my students said, what are you going to do? Why are you leaving to go to California? Going to Disneyland? And I said, no, I wish. What I'm doing is this keynote. And I explained to them what it is, and then they started bossing me around, because that's how my kids work. They're like, make sure you don't do this, and make sure you don't do that. And I said, whoa, 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 slow your roll, and let me get this on camera.
Don't be boring. You should, like, let them, like, ask questions and let them, like, say what they want to say and then, like, give them a response.
You gotta, like, talk about tech, but make it, like, modernized and funny. Like, get to know, like, the people and, like, make sure you're not talking about, like, something that was in the 80s or something.
Make sure you go to the bathroom before you have a speech and make sure you don't pee on yourself. That'd be, like, so embarrassing.
Just throw out some words like bam, and then they all wake up and stuff like that. So surprise them like with a tough question to make them think. Ask a question about the Constitution, they won't even see it coming.
Probably maybe have all the audience take a couple of selfies. Like
You should not be looking off to the side.
Revelle Blayton, please come down for elite dismissal.
What?
Revelle Blayton, please come down for dismissal.
No! By Miss Magiera.
Honestly, make them get up and dance. That'd be funny.
All right. I love it when I get applause for my students doing stuff. I'm like, yeah, I totally did that. No, not really. But they did, and I'll share that with them. And I just want to do a recap as a good teacher would, so just make sure we synthesize that learning, shall we? So what did we learn? Don't be boring. All right, I'm going to try my best. Tell jokes. I heard a sweet joke from Matt Vaudry right before I got up about a duck and a bar. I don't think I can recreate it, but he's right in the front row if you need a joke. Ask hard questions. Use the bathroom beforehand so you don't pee on yourself. I don't know if you guys heard that, but that's what John Paul said. He was really concerned I'd pee my pants on stage. And finally, take a selfie. That's what Jalen said. He's like, why don't you take a selfie? So we're going to start by asking hard questions. So, you know, the thing I like about giving keynotes is they're a chance to share what we're doing in Chicago and to share my students' voice and message. And I really strongly believe in that. Otherwise, I wouldn't come around and do it. But the thing I hate about keynotes is that you take a bunch of teachers, put them in the room, and say, hey, here's good pedagogy, by doing the worst possible pedagogy, which is I stand up here and talk at you, and y'all have to shut up and look at me for an hour. Actually, no, now it's 33 minutes. That's how much we have left. So I'm going to try and flip the script a little. I don't think I could quite differentiate and do small group sessions in here. There's a few too many of you, and I don't think we have the right furniture. But I want to leverage social media like Twitter to make the impossible possible. And that's what technology is about, right? Taking impossible situations and making them possible. So how many of you are on Twitter? Woo! If you see the person next to you whose hand is not raised, grab their phone and help them out. So what I'd like to do is I'm going to send you guys via the screen through your eyes a series of questions throughout the keynote. And I want to crowdsource this keynote so you're not just learning from and with me, but from and with each other as well. And so I want to see you guys responding to each other, meeting new people. And that's huge. Some of my best friends that I've ever met, my edu soulmates, have been people I met at conferences. In fact, this entire front row of people, I would never have met them had I not talked to someone at a conference. Diane Main was just like singing at a stand at ISTE. I actually don't even remember how I met half of you, but I know it was at a conference. But the thing is if I had stayed in my silo and gone around the entire event just with my friends and not been brave enough to say hello, I'd be missing half of the really close friends I have today. So what I want to do is figure out how many people have affinity with someone they've never met here before. And so we're going to do exactly what Jalen said and take some affinity selfies. What you're going to do is you're going to turn to the person in front or back. You're going to make like Catholic Church, peace be with you. And I hope you have your hand sanitizer. You're going to meet someone, for people who aren't Catholic, it's a thing we do in church. And I want you to introduce someone to you don't know. Is my friend Louise here? Louise, stand up. Louise and I were on United Airlines flight number, I forget the flight, from Chicago to Palm Springs yesterday, and I was sitting next to her, and we're chatting, and it turns out that she's going to the Q conference, and I said, so am I, and I said, what are you doing there? And she's like, I'm a first-time attendee, I'm learning, and she said, what are you doing? And I said, I'm giving the keynote. And Louise is from Tunbridge, Vermont, which is a really small and beautiful town in central Vermont. It's gorgeous near Burlington, right? And she's got some of her homeboys and homegirls there with her, right? Tunbridge in the house? You guys sit down. Sorry, Louise, I won't make you keep standing. But Louise had never been on Twitter before. But as we were talking, we found out all these things that were similar. She's a first-time user on Twitter. Go ahead and follow her. Let's see if we can get her 5,000 Twitter followers. And tweeted her from hashtag Q15. When we got down, I had a wireless on the airplane, but when she got down and turned her phone up, her like phone was blowing up with all the Twitter notifications. I did not teach her how to turn that off. So what I want to do now, though, is see if you can find your Louise in the audience. Try and find someone who makes your heart warm, who inspires you, someone you've never met before. And I'd like for you to take a selfie with them. And just in a few words, say something you have in common and tweet it, hashtag Q15. You guys think you could do that? Yeah, you can. Just say yes. Just smile and nod. All right. One last thing. You get bonus points if you take an Asian selfie. That means if you do one of these, see, look, like that. All right, guys, go ahead.
Let me take a selfie.
Find somebody. Hi, Robbie. I'm Jenny. Where are you from? Livermore? How's that? Oh, me too. All right, that'll be our thing. We both like enchiladas. Part where I ask all the students to sit down after I let them do something fun. Raise your hand if you met someone new. So here's the thing, guys. I went into the audience and I ran down there and I met my new friend Ravi. Hey, Ravi, what up? We both like enchiladas. He's from Oakland and he has the best Twitter handle ever. It's Darth Learner. Oh my God, amazing. Someone call Steve Dembo. All right. So now that you've met your new friends, they might be your new edu soulmate, they might be the person who answers your prayers, or it might have just been a nice way to shake hands and trade germs. But I'm hoping that you take this idea throughout the conference and meet new people. Now, let's get back to the originally scheduled programming, the keynote. Good, we're starting at 26 minutes left, the keynote. So beware the transformation trap. Now, the reason that I started talking about this was because as I went around through my schools, I realized that more and more schools are buying technology, which is a good thing. The thing I used to try and fight was please buy technology. And then after a while, that wasn't the thing I was trying to get them to do. You see, they were buying technology to transform things, to transform their classrooms. And they were always looking for something different, which I agreed with. There are a lot of things about education that we want to change. The thing is about that, though, is that always good to be different? For example, does anyone remember this guy? The original iPhone. Does anyone remember when it came out? I'm just going to assume that the incoherent murmuring is June 29th, 2007, in which case you're correct. I remember because it was 7 days after my birthday. Do the math and send me a present, please. So I remember it came out, and the first time I saw it, I was amazed. I was like, what is this space phone? It doesn't even have buttons. And the thing with me is whenever something new comes out, I'm always the last one to get it right before the new one comes out. So, like, I get the iPhone 1, and then you know that if I'm in an Apple store buying it, the next one's coming out the next day. And so we're always fighting to get the next new thing. Like, I have my iPhone 37 right here. I'm really excited about it. And everything new seems sexy. If it's new and different, it seems really cool. And I ask you to audit that and to really stop for a second and say, is it better just because it's different?
When we designed the 5C, we were going for affordability without sacrificing quality. We realized that for some consumers, it still may not be affordable. So we challenged ourselves. How can we make an even more accessible model? And that's why we're proud to announce the iPhone 5F.
The new display can show up to 50 pixels at any given time. That's the highest resolution the human eye can see at 3 weeks old.
And don't forget the App Store. We have all your favorite app.
Snake is back, and it's the same as ever.
You're gonna love Snake.
Careful though, if the Snake gets too long, it will shut down the phone's processor.
So, if you wanna watch the whole thing, it's on YouTube. The thing is about that transformation is, yes, the iPhone 5F is different. It's different from the 5C, the 1, all of these things. But we need to audit transformation. When things are changing, we need to ask ourselves, hold up, is it better? And if the answer is no, we want to ask ourselves, why are we doing it? Because sometimes you walk into a classroom and things look real cool and real different and very exciting. But if you take a step back and ask, is it better? And I don't just mean test scores. I don't just mean, our kids sitting in seats and our attendance higher. I mean, is it qualitatively changing the experience for our students in a better way? So I want you to ask yourself, what are you here to get better at? Why did you come to Q? Are you here to get better at blogging or Twitter or Google or selfies? And if the answer is yes, that's great. But what I'd like to push you to think about is it's not really these tools that you're trying to get better at. You're trying to get better at differentiating instruction, at supporting teachers, at inspiring students. The technology comes second. It's a vehicle to do what you're already doing. And my fear about using technology is that we're going to forget the most important person who can transform things for our kids, and that's teachers. Now, I say this as someone whose title is literally digital learning coordinator. I make money by doing the technology thing. I'm not saying don't use tech. I'm saying trust teachers and remember why we're doing it. So what I'd like for you to do for your question number two is, what are you here to get better at? And don't name a tool, name a strategy, name a pedagogy. Use the word students, use the word learning, excitement, inspiration. Write that down and tweet it under hashtag Q15. And while you're doing that, I'm gonna keep going. So, different isn't always better. It can be, but it isn't always. For example, when I first started using technology, I had 32 iPads in my classroom in 2010 before you could Google how to use iPads in your classroom. And I had no idea what to do. So I looked up cool things to do with iPads in the classroom. Got zero hits, took out the words iPads, put in computers, got flipped classroom. I didn't really know what it was, but after learning more about flipped classroom, I figured out the basic gist about video instruction. The problem is the building that I taught in then and the buildings that I still support now are above 90% free and reduced lunch. In the city of Chicago, we're the 32 lowest income and highest need schools. So our kids aren't quote unquote digital natives. When they go home, they neither have internet access nor a personal computer. So how was I gonna do flipped classroom if I couldn't have them watch the videos at home? Well, I created differentiated videos and had them watch them in class so as to clone the teacher. I was going to sit off to the side and teach a small group lesson, but instead I videotaped them learning for the entire 45 minutes because I could not believe how quiet 47 fourth and fifth graders were. Listen, the sound of silence. And I was amazed. I was like, oh my God, I am the best teacher in the history of humanity. I took this video and I ran up and down the hallway and I showed all of my colleagues. I was like, look what I did today. And if someone had asked me, is it better? I would have said, hell yeah, it's better. Look how quiet my kids are. But here's the thing. Upon reflection, which is really important when you're going through an audit process, I realized that compliance does not equal engagement. And my students looked like they were learning. They were real quiet. But some of you have heard this story before, and what they were actually doing was remixing my absolutely epic video on factors and how amazing they are to your world, so that they said something that starts with an F and doesn't end in factor. They remixed it, and one of them figured out how to hack it and put it on YouTube. So they all looked real quiet, but they weren't doing math. So different doesn't always equal better. We need to make sure that our kids are given the tools and know how to use them for good and not for evil, but we also need to make sure that as teachers, we know how to give them that agency. So what I am set out on a quest to do is figure out different and better. What does it look like when you bring technology into the classroom and create opportunities that were otherwise impossible without the devices at hand? Shout out to Sammer Model. So, engagement. When we think about engagement, we think about authentic learning. 2 years ago, the city of Chicago went on strike. And by city of Chicago, I mean the teachers, because in my mind, that is the entire city of Chicago. Now, we went on strike for a myriad of reasons, but as it happens when adults have conflict, the kids blame themselves. Is it because I didn't turn in my homework on Friday? Is it because Eddie smells? No, it's because we have big problems. And so we wanted our kids to understand what was going on, and they drilled it down to money, and they said, it's because you don't get paid enough, it's because they don't give us enough money to buy more Promethean boards. So we played this game called QR Code Price is Right, where the kids named the top 20 items in our classroom that they thought they couldn't live without. I only got one vote, but as the fascist dictator, I went ahead and put myself on the list. And then they would go around and they would scan the QR code. First they had to guess the price without going over because it was Price is Right rules. And then afterwards, they had to scan the code to reveal the actual price. And they did all these spreadsheet works and all that good stuff. After that, we tweeted out our findings. And the kids tweeted out things like, I can't believe Miss Magiera gets paid so much. She's real rich. And I was like, I know, right? Look at me. I'm amazing. Obviously, I'm rich. Just kidding. But they also tweeted out things like, why don't we burn our garbage? It's ridiculous that we spend $35 on this garbage can when we could burn it or throw it out the window. The conservation center in the state of Alaska wrote back a really long letter to my fifth graders about why you should not burn your garbage and how it affects their state. So my kids were getting a lot of access, but one of the things that came back from that tweet, from those tweets, were a Northside school, still in Chicago Public Schools, only about 3 miles north, wanted to do the same activity and jump on a Skype to discuss it. And when my kids got on the Skype, instead of saying, what were the top 20 items you selected in your class, and what was the average price of each? They said, oh my God, you guys have white kids in your school. Now, I asked my students, why did you say that? Because they actually didn't say, oh my God, they said, holy shit. And I meant, why did you say that, like the S word? But they said, because Miss Magiera, they have white kids. There's one right there, and one right there, and one right there. And my kids are walking up to the Promethean board and pointing out the white kids while they're still live on the Skype. And the other kids are like, I can't tell if this is racist. So then my students look at me as if to say, like, they actually said, like, where do we get white people? White, we don't have any. And you know, I'm like, they come from Palm Springs, California. And so the thing is after we all like got over our initial shock, the other class said, wait a second, I thought that Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. ended racism and segregation like 100 years ago. So how come that class is still segregated? At which point my kid said, holy shit, we're still segregated? Now, I could have gone down this road two ways. I could have really harped on the second use of the S word in, you know, as many as 5 minutes. I could have said, no, you're not segregated. That's silly. You could go to that school and brush it under the rug, or I could have them Google it. So they went on Google, and they just typed in their questions. They wrote, am I segregated? Is the mayor racist? How do I get out of here? And we learned about smart searching, and eventually the kids came up with things like this. These are maps of the city of Chicago. The one on the top left are violent crimes by neighborhood. The darker the orange, the more violent the crimes. Notice where they're centered, the west and south side. That's where our schools are. The second one is talking about the median income level. The redder it is, the poorer the neighborhood, west and south side. The third one is Chicago public schools that are failing. The darker the color, the more they are failing, west and south side. The final one is how the concentration of African Americans per neighborhood has changed in the past 30 years in the city of Chicago. And notice that all four maps are identical. Also notice where all the African Americans are mostly concentrated, the west and south side. Now, my students, again, being 100% African-American in this particular school, were aghast, as they should be. And they were really upset that this was happening, and I said, what do you guys want to do about it? And beyond, like, there was a little bit of violence, I'm not going to lie, we had to talk to them about nonviolent resolution. They wanted to burn down the mayor's house. And so we had to talk about, like, why that wouldn't be okay, but that was a good learning experience. They finally decided that what they wanted to do was get kids to stay in school, and I just about lost my mind. I was crying in front of students, which you're not supposed to do. I was so happy. And I said, why do you say that education is the answer? I'm like texting my mom, like, Mom, I made it. And they said, because if kids can stay in school, they can go to college. And I'm like, yup, good job, live tweeting this. And then they said they can grow up and get a really, really wealthy and high-paying job like being a teacher. And then they can buy a car and drive out of the bad neighborhoods. Now, here's the thing. While I was a little simplistic, you can't just drive out of poverty. The logic was sound, right? Education leads to opportunity. So I said, how are we going to get kids to stay in school? And my kids looked right at me, and they said, make it suck less. So I asked how we can make it suck less, and they said, well, we really like these iPads. We really like what's going on in the classroom, and we want to do more of that. How did you get these iPads? And I said, I wrote a grant. And they said, let's find grants. So we went on the Google, and we looked up grants, and we found out that there was a state grant that you could apply for $100,000 to improve schools. And so my 9 and 10-year-olds downloaded said grants, and we embarked in writing it. At the end of it, they wrote grants that followed every single step that this grant meant for stodgy old adults like us to write, asked them to do. They created keynote presentations with a lot of transition effects. Sparkle, blast, glitter, burn. So they created these, and then we had this final day where it was going to be like a Shark Tank type thing, where people they wanted in the school, like the principal, their favorite teachers, parents, kids from other classes, could watch their presentation. I know, it's still going. And my kids said to me, we don't actually want to do our keynotes. And I said, why? And they said, because no one would sit in a room and watch someone do a slideshow presentation. Awkward. So they decided to create videos, and they created entire trailers that you can find on YouTube now, and that was really exciting. But the thing I really want to share about this story is that they got so excited because it was authentic. It was based in a challenge that they were truly feeling, not a challenge that I pulled out of a project-based learning book, not a challenge that came out of a word problem, but a challenge that was authentic to their experience. Another example is, this is our school right here, National Teachers Academy, the school where my office is and I taught in forever, and now that I'm based out of. And right here is 9094, the Kennedy, our big highway in Chicago, and Cermak Road. All of this green space is where the Chicago Housing Authority buildings called the Harold Ickes Homes, AKA the projects, used to be. That's where my kids used to live. After they tore them down because the buildings were no longer structurally sound, now it's a hotbed of not so nice people hanging out and doing not so nice things. And that's where my students walk home every day. So this was before the whole Safe Passage Chicago thing came out, and my kids said, this is a problem. Kids are getting really dangerous situations. We want to solve it. So they went online and they found an app challenge and they brought it to school and they said, Miss Magiera, we want to do this during math class. And I said, okay, let's figure it out. Here are the Common Core standards we have to hit. How are we going to do it? So we were in a geometry unit and they decided to create an app called Kid Trek, a safe journey app for kids. They were showing me how to do parallel lines, right angles, shapes. They also were showing me how to find rate and distance and scale, which was in another unit that we hadn't even gotten to yet. And by the end, my students had not only hit every single Common Core state standard that I was supposed to teach, but also created an app that would make their community more safe.
Hey children, have you ever wondered, am I going to make a home safe right now? Who's out here in these streets right now? Hey parents, have you ever wondered, is my child being harassed right now? Will my child feel comfortable right now? Well, I have the right app for you, Kid Track. It keeps track of your child going from home to school, going from school to home, anywhere, by one click of a button. It tells you and the police if your child is in danger right now. Do your child feel comfortable right now? Is the surroundings good right now?
So, again, that's on YouTube too. You can watch the whole thing. But the last question that I want, or the next question I want you guys to tweet out under the hashtag Q15 is, what do your kids wonder about? Don't worry about the curricular integration yet. Just think, when they're doing something in class or talking about something in class, then you say, stop it. What is it that they were doing? And this is me all the time. My kids are talking about like so-and-so's shoes, he's bullying him, the people they saw in the park yesterday, what's going on, how much money Miss Magiera makes as a teacher. And I'm always like, stop it, do these factors. Take a second and stop yourself and say, what is it that they're trying to do? What is it that they're interested about? And can I use that passion and funnel it into what I'm teaching? So with engagement comes creation. You saw that as my students were having these authentic learning experiences, they were all materializing themselves into creating something, whether it be a grant or an app. And so as my students began to create more and more, they began to expect it. This is Jalen and John Paul. You might recognize them from the Boss Miss Magiera How to Do a Keynote video. And they decided after school they wanted to learn how to build an army of T-1000 robots to take over the world. And I said, sure. So they took all of the garbage out of my office that were boxes that our computers and Chromebooks and iPads had come out of, and they began to build a robot. They were really upset to find that they didn't have any of the gears or electronics to make it work. So what they decided to do was find other ways to make it interactive.
I put tape right here so he can eat any Cheetos garbage.
He was so excited. He ran up and down the hall saying, like, look, my robot can eat. It's so exciting. And they had a ton of fun. But what they began to realize was they didn't really want to learn how to make their robot physically interactive. They wanted to learn how to program it to be a sentient being to take over the world, AKA Skynet. So my students figured out that what they really wanted to learn how to do was code. The problem is those of you who have tried to learn how to code, it's literally learning a new language. And when you learn a new language, you need to practice every single day. And we really didn't have time to do that, so they wanted to bring coding into the classroom. They wanted to have a daily coding class. And they weren't really sure how to boss their principal around to make that happen. And so they decided to create a viral video.
I'm about to code some tabs. Only got 20 lines in my Chromebook. I'm coding, writing HTML. This is coding awesome.
So they posted on YouTube, and again, my kids don't have computers at home. They don't have internet access at home, so every morning before school, they're waiting out front as I drive up, and they're dragging in another random adult from their house, from their neighbor, some guy they found on the street, to come and watch their video. And as they would watch it, they'd be like, look at what we did! We're so much better than Macklemore, am I right? And I'd say, yes, you are. And they'd refresh, and they'd refresh, and they'd be like, look at how many people are looking at our video! And finally, I had to say, that's you, stop refreshing. And while a lot of those views are my students refreshing over and over again, the thing is a lot of the views were people like you watching it, seeing it, and one of the views was the principal of the school, and now they have coding in their building every single day from kindergarten to eighth grade. Now, that wasn't enough. My kids wanted to figure out how coding could be more tangible. They loved coding, but they realized that coding wasn't as immediately, viscerally satisfying as building a robot. And luckily, we were able to find a set of robots called Dash and Dot by Wonder Workshop. We brought those in, and the kids have started coding on their iPads, and now Dash and Dot are their new minions, and their dreams are literally coming true. They're so excited. What they're in the middle of doing right now is creating a new music video fully choreographed through code where Dash dances around Dot. So stay tuned for Q16. But the thing about this that's so cool is as my kids were creating these things, they're making videos that are changing the scope and sequence and literally the curriculum of their classroom. They're coding with robots. The questions that they are asked at home when they get to their parents is not, hey guys, what did you learn today? But hey guys, what did you create today? And that's been a huge mind shift for our families, to ask their kids what they created today. So what I'd like for you to do is think back to when you were a kid and try and think of that really awesome worksheet that you did. Why are you laughing? I'm serious. No, I'm kidding. Maybe you remember because it was really stressful for you, but you probably remember creating something, that book, that diorama, that anything, sewing something for the school play. You probably remember making something, and if your parents are as hoardery as mine, you probably still own it. So for this one, you actually get a prize for tweeting. Make Wonder, so the Wonder Workshop has offered that anyone who answers this and tweets both the hashtag Q15 and the Make Wonder, they're gonna pick from one of those tweets and give out a free Dash and Dot to someone in the audience. So go ahead and tweet out what you remember creating when you were in school, and make sure to include both hashtags Q15 and Make Wonder. Now, as our kids are creating more and more, they get really excited because they have this authentic audience. They have people who are looking at what they're making and giving them real feedback. And as they realize that their voice has a lot more breadth and scope than they ever imagined, that creation turns into empowerment. Because they realize that what they create and what they say matters no matter how small they are. And this last story I want to tell you is about one of my good friends and colleagues, Lindsay Rose. Lindsay Rose is a math teacher, a fifth grade math teacher on the south side of Chicago in a neighborhood called South Shore. Myra Bradwell School of Excellence is in a neighborhood of Chicago that you usually hear about in movies when they're trying to say something negative about inner city populations. The school that she taught in was turned around because it was so dangerous and it was failing so badly. And every single day she's expected to be on a certain part of her curriculum, to meet these test scores, to make annual yearly progress, and if she doesn't, they will shut down her school. This math teacher heard her students talking before class about how upset they were about the way people were talking about their schools. They were so upset because these students were hearing everyone refer to their area of Chicago as Terror Town. The South Shore neighborhood of Chicago has the highest per capita murder rate in the city, and the city of Chicago has the highest per capita murder rate in all of the United States. It's so bad that rappers and other popular media figures have renamed Chicago to Chi-Rac. So our students, who are living in the most violent neighborhood, in the most violent city in the nation, were really upset that that's the only story that was being told. Because for them, the South Shore neighborhood isn't about guns and violence, but about their families, their school, and where they call home. So Lindsay Rose, the math teacher, decided to take out a book called The House on Mango Street. Has anyone read this by Sandra Cisneros? Awesome book. And she's decided to use it as a mentor text to help her students tell a counter narrative about their home. They wrote, they tweeted, they blogged, they posted it on social media. And it gained so much traction that news trucks and news vans flooded to the South Shore neighborhood. And for the first time in what the community says is over 100 years, they were coming to tell a story that was positive and not negative.
We saw your news trucks and cameras here, and we read your article, Six Shot in South Shore Laundromat and Another Mass Shooting in Terror Town.
We saw the news reporters with fancy suits in front of our laundromat.
You spent 24 hours here, but you really don't know us.
Those who don't know us think this is a poor neighborhood with those abandoned buildings with the wood covering the windows and broken doors.
Those who don't know us saw the police on the corner and think that we're all violence and drugs.
They see the candy wrappers and empty juice bottles and think we don't care.
Uneducated, jobless thieves, you'll be scared of these heartless people.
When you see us coming, you might hurry up and run to your cars and lock the doors.
Then speed down these streets at 60 miles per hour like you're on a highway, trying to get out of this ghetto.
We want you to know us, we aren't afraid. We know that man at the corner. He works at the store and gives us free lemon heads.
Those girls jumping rope are Precious, Anaya, and Nivea.
The people in suits are not going to finish but to church.
That little creepy dog is Sionis, Lamar's dog.
We are the kids who find crates so we can shoot hoops.
When the sun shines here, it's not God saying he wants to burn us, but he sees us all with bright futures.
Those who know us look at the ones who want to go to college, not the ones who dropped out.
If you listen, you'll hear the laughter and chatter from the group of girls on the corner who are best friends and really care about each other.
Do you see the smile on the cashier's face when the kids walk in? Why? Because this neighborhood is filled with love.
This isn't Chi-Rac. This is home. This is us.
Lindsay Rose is a math teacher in one of the most difficult neighborhoods in our nation, in one of the hardest schools. She's expected to toe the line. She's expected to do exactly what the curriculum says one tells her to. But she believes that she has another mission, and that's to make things better for her students. And she's willing to take a risk. She's willing to say, I can do this. I can be a champion for my students. And I can leverage these really amazing tools that have never been out there for us before to give my students access to a voice, to amplify their message, so that every single continent, with the exception of that cold one, has seen this video. So that news trucks, NPR, Chicago Sun-Times, the Tribune, the New York Times, have seen this video, and people are hearing a positive message about their home. Now, Lindsay did this, but taking a risk is scary, especially when, as teachers, so often we have so little control over what we do. But we're the champions in front of our students every day. We're the ones who wake up in the morning and stand in front of them. And so I want to leave you with this last task that Jalen asked us to do. And let's model taking a risk, being brave, and being willing to fail and put ourselves on blast. You know, Jalen asked us to ask hard questions, don't pee on yourself, take a selfie. But they also asked us to dance.
Honestly, make them get up and dance. That'd be funny.
How do you think I'm going to make a bunch of grown-ups get up and dance? What if they don't want to?
Well, kids can make them do it.
Do it for the kids. Guilt trip. Now, my students are right now working on a new music video because they saw this clip from Ellen. Maybe you saw it.
All right, let's try it again. Hit it.
All right, so they do it. But then Ellen said to them, I know.
I want to challenge everyone.
But then Ellen said,
I want to challenge everyone at home to learn that dance too and upload it to ElleTube.
So my kids said, challenge accepted. And they decided that they wanted to be on ElleTube because they're already YouTube famous. Why not be RealTube famous? So,
hit it.
Now, I want to point out some things while we're watching this. Some of them have no idea what's going on. They figure it out, but a lot of times Latrell in the back is just like, I'm just here. If you watch each of them differently, like John Paul's in it for a little while, and then he's like, I think I might be bored. But they keep going. They took a risk, and they knew that I was going to show this video to all of you. Now, everyone take a look at all these very eager teachers right here on the side of the stage. These are my friends who I met at a conference, and I asked them last night at like 9 o'clock at night, I think the title of the email was, would you like to get on stage during the keynote and humiliate yourselves? And they all said yes. So come on up. Now, what we're gonna do here is we're gonna model risk-taking. It's gonna probably be a hot mess. These jerks practiced a bunch before the keynote. You might have heard them clapping backstage, but I really have no idea how this dance goes. I'm gonna have you videotape this, so it can be my 1 second for today. You guys use that app, it's amazing. Anyway, they've taken their shoes off. Are we doing that? Are we taking, okay, I'll take my shoe off too, there you go. So, all right, here we go. So we're gonna do this. Now what we'd like you to do is get up with us and take a risk. We're modeling risk taking and failure. So come on up, and my students have asked you to join us. The amazing videographers here who are from, what are you guys called? Elias? Alas Media are going to record you, and I'm gonna go back to Chicago and share it with my kids, and then we're gonna submit it to the Ellen Show. It's gonna be messy, but just watch me. I have no idea what I'm doing. Are you guys ready? Here we go. Oh, and I also have to tell you one other thing. My friend Molly, I was about not to do it, and my friend Follow Molly goes, what's the worst you can do? Just run away back to Chicago. And if that doesn't work, show him pictures of sad kids. All right, are you guys ready to take a risk? Let's do this.
Go. Hit it.
so out of breath. Oh, God, I should have exercised before I did that. All right. So, guys, did you guys have fun? Here's what I want you to do as you go out in the next 2 days of Q15. Meet new people, take risks, and make it better for our kids. You are the champions. Thank you.